Oye, Komeng, und willkommen for a science epic literature review. Today we are taking a look at the 8th book in the Expanse series, Tiamat's Wrath by James S.A. Corey. Now last year I did a read and review of Persepolis Rising, the 7th book and the preceding novel to this one. If you'd like to check that out, it's in the link in the description down below. I really enjoyed Persepolis Rising, and books 7, 8, and 9 are considered to be the ending arc, closing up the entire story. And the 9th book should be coming out sometime next year in 2021. But as of reviewing this right now, Tiamat's Wrath is the latest book in the series. Now, in the time since doing that read and review of Persepolis Rising, I was able to read the 5th book, Nemesis Games, which many people thought is the penultimate best book in the entire series. A lot of heavy stuff happened in that book. A lot of heavy things came down. A lot of heavy things went down, if you know what I mean. And the 5th book was a really deep emotional struggle for one of the characters in particular, Naomi Nagata. And that took me by surprise because I was thinking that it was going to be more about Holden, but it wasn't. And that's the cool thing that I'm discovering, is that there are no main characters. There is no main character in this book. No one's the chosen one. And it's all about a group of people, the plots unfolding for a bunch of people. And that's what makes things more sweeping and epic. I think books 5 and 6, Nemesis Games and Babylon's Ashes, should be read in one go for the full experience. And things kind of got cut off at the end of Nemesis Games, and that's all I have to say about that. Now this book, Tiamat's Wrath, picks up after the 7th book. It continues one of the major plot threads in the Expanse that the authors have been building up in the background all this while, and that is the coming of the unknown aggressors. And they are a mysterious alien threat that killed off the creators of the protomolecule and the ring builder civilization that built a series of gate networks connected to 1300 worlds scattered across the Milky Way. And they are this hive mind civilization that resorted to destroying entire solar systems in order to stop the unknown aggressors. So the unknown aggressors are really like the Game of Thrones equivalent of the White Walkers of the series. And even up to this point in book 8, we don't really know what they are or what they look like. So it really keeps things mysterious and threatening. But what we do know so far is that they can do some serious damage to all of humankind. And in this book, they do just that. They inflict their wrath. So Tiamat's Wrath, and Tiamat being a reference to an ancient Babylonian goddess of sea salt. And their wrath refers to that of the unknown aggressors and what they inflict on interstellar humanity after having colonized most of the 1300 extra solar systems of the Ringgate network. And all of this is set against the backdrop of another conflict as humanity continues to bicker and fight amongst itself. Right off the get-go, at the beginning of this book, we find our main characters, the crew of the Rocinante, now an aging Martian gunship corvette, engaged in a rebellion against the Laconian Empire, and the Laconians were the bad guys in the last book. The Laconian Empire was able to take over all of human civilization using ships built on protomolecule technology. I definitely felt like this book had some Star Wars Episode 4 original trilogy vibes going on about it, because the main characters were involved in an underground movement to topple the Empire. Some of the crew members were preferring a more direct confrontational approach, such as Bobby Draper, while others preferred a more subtle socio-political erosion style strategy, such as that supported by Naomi Nagata. And they're all trying to figure out how to topple the evil Empire, which was led by Interstellar Il Duce himself, Space Führer, High Consul Winston Duarte, who has installed himself as the immortal God King on top of the Laconian Empire. I definitely got this vibe of a bunch of plucky rebels trying to fight against this strong empire as I was reading the opening chapters. There's even a scene at the end of it where the Rocinante has to do a bit of a Death Star trench run on some orbital platforms, and I'm not complaining, it was all really epic. Now, just like Game of Thrones, where characters can die and get removed from the board at any time, that totally happens here. We had the main bad guy, as I mentioned, High Consul Duarte, get totally sidelined well before the halfway mark, just like that, because of the unknown aggressors. And one of the other evil scientist bad guys gets killed within a paragraph. You just hear he's behind the door and you hear a thump and then boom, he's gone. I'm referring to Dr. Cortazar. Yeah, as the novel progresses and the situation is breaking down, Duarte's successors try to hold it all together. And this leads me to one of the things that is lacking in the novel, and that is I wish I could have seen more in terms of the internal power structure of the Laconians, like sub-factions vying for power within the whole palace intrigue that's happening halfway through. It's hard to believe that this Duarte guy arranged his government to be so hierarchical that only his decisions mattered and he didn't have kind of like a sub-congress underneath. But in the end, you just get these two guys, Admiral Trejo and Colonel Illich. So I really wish we could have seen more of the leadership of the Laconian Empire. And Duarte himself was really quite an interesting character early on in the presence of one of the new POV characters, his daughter Teresa, who was being trained as his backup successor. I thought of her character development within the span of the novel was great, even though it can be difficult to write children and younger characters into these kinds of settings. I know that Isaac Asimov did it in the second Foundation novel with Arcadia Durrell. Now, early on in this novel, you get this 14-year-old child being taught the subtleties of interstellar politics and being prepared for a leadership role by her father. With regards to Duarte, you get to see a glimpse of the mind behind the madness before all hell breaks loose. And when all hell does break loose is where the novel really picks up. It's where you really start to enjoy the story and you are at the edge of your seat and wanting to know more about the unknown aggressors and how they can defy causality and switch off consciousness just like that.
They are able to make entire ships disappear and take chunks of matter out of existence. So it's really unlike any extraterrestrial threat that the Expanse universe has ever seen before. And in fact, you can't really see what these things are. I do believe they are kind of extra dimensional at this point.
It's at this point where things get really bloody for one of the main characters. And the Expanse is full of strong female characters. That prize in the last novel in Persepolis Rising went to Kamina Drummer. I think Kamina Drummer is winning all those prizes, but in this novel, she doesn't really play a big part. And I suspect it may be curtains called for her character, or maybe not. We'll see in the ninth book. She might be making a comeback. But in this book, we get Dr. Elvie Okoye, who has not been seen since the fourth book, since Kibola Burn. And we saw her in season 4 of the TV series. And it's hard to believe that the TV series has been going on for like 5 years now, since 2015. Time really flies, just like the Rocinante on a high G burn, on a high G maneuver. So we have Dr. Elvie Okoye, who's one of the main POV characters in this book. And she plays a big role in this one, trying to fix things and figuring out how to fight back against the metaphorical wrath of Tiamat.
Dr. Elvie is an exobiologist or astrobiologist that goes on a romp across the galaxy searching for ancient proto-molecule artifacts that might be used to turn the tide against the unknown aggressors. And her experience is remarkable because within her lifetime, exobiology goes from this completely theoretical field of study to a more experimental discipline with various practical applications and an extremely expansive sample size. It says in the book that when she was starting off on her PhD, it would have been lucky enough for her to have discovered some microbes on some distant moon within the solar system. And then with the ring gates opening up, 1,300 new biomes become explorable, available to study. And of course, there is the protomolecule creator civilization itself that is a major source of inquiry. It turns out that humans were not alone in the cosmos and that there is other intelligent life out there that far surpassed 24th century humanity in terms of their technological capability. And it's pretty much a remarkable transition of a worldview to experience. And I'm sure that if we are able to experience that kind of paradigm shift in terms of our interpretation of our place in the universe, that would be incredible. Even for 21st century humanity to experience, that would be insane. So yeah, shouts out to all my friends out there, brothers and sisters in the field of biology that spend their time studying squishy things, carbon-based or otherwise.
My favorite scene really in the entire book is when everyone is just tripping and losing their minds because of the metaphorical Tiamat is switching off consciousness across the galaxy, and they are starting to be referred to as these dark gods lurking in the unseen universe. And Elvi Okoye straight up tells Admiral Treo, the big bad military general in charge, to do the right thing, surrender to the underground. And that really took guts. And that chapter to me was my favorite chapter in the entire book. It was really chilling and spine tingling. I feel like the expanse in this final arc in book 7, 8, and 9, and I felt this way too in book 5 when the Barkeep disappeared into the gate. I feel like the expanse is starting to venture off into similar territory of another book that I had read during the lockdown, and that is Cheesin Liu's The Dark Forest, which is this critically acclaimed modern sci-fi classic. We are getting now into the eighth book, not just a war within the human race between factions of humanity, but also between alien civilizations. The Dark Forest talks about this idea of cosmic sociology and how if alien races were to encounter each other, it would be far more practical and beneficial to shoot first and ask questions later. And that reasoning is built on a concept of game theory called the prisoner's dilemma as a solution to the Fermi paradox. I won't explain it all here, but basically the universe is a dark forest and intelligent civilizations are all hunters in the forest. The odds are better for your survival if you are to hide, not be seen, and kill everything rather than cooperate, even though if you cooperate, there is a slight chance that both sides might win. And there's a little truth table in here, actually. I'd like to open up page 45. There's a little truth table that kind of explains the logic behind it. And Winston Duarte thought that he could force the unknown aggressors to the cooperation table by attacking them with antimatter. Brilliant. Absolutely brilliant. So, yeah, the stakes are really high in this novel, not just for the characters, not just for one particular faction, Belters, Martians, Inyaloda, or Earthers. Yeah, the stakes are high for the entirety of human civilization in the expanse across the 1300 worlds, which is something that the previous novels were only lightly touching up on and building up on. Now, my only other gripe in this novel is that the pacing towards the end is kind of jarring, as the 1000-year Reich of the Laconian Empire is crumbling. The chapters jump a little forward and backward in time during the Siege of Laconia, which is something that usually doesn't happen in the Expanse books. Everything is usually quite linear.
There's one really interesting scene that happens during the Siege of Laconia, where the Laconian government tries to celebrate Teresa Duarte's birthday as the planet is being bombarded by nuclear warheads. And everyone's just trying to maintain a straight face of like, everything's okay, and they're trying to put their poker face on and try to assume a sense of normality. And that totally reminded me of the German film Der Untergang, when towards the end of the Second World War, people were trying to celebrate the Führer's birthday as the Russians were bombarding Berlin, and suddenly they're dancing in this room, and like an artillery shell happens to explode nearby. And we get something like that in this book.
Now, speaking of the Siege of Laconia as well, I definitely thought that as far as the ending set piece space battle goes, the Siege of Laconia was way more interesting than the Battle of Point Leuctra, which was the big space battle in Persepolis Rising. This one actually had decent tactics and strategy behind it, and it really felt more like a real campaign. And if you've ever played the original Homeworld or Homeworld Remastered, you have this mission where you have to lead rebellion ships to knock out the defenses around Higara. Yeah, that's what it felt like to me.
You get to see this ragtag group of underground coalition ships trying to lay siege to a more technologically superior enemy. And the underground ships are of various different sizes and types, while the Laconians have this beast of a machine called a pulsar destroyers and magnetar battleships.
Now, before I go, as science epic is a science channel, and as I am an astronomy major, I have to talk about some real science. There's this part in this novel where Elvie Okoye discovers a neutron star with a mass that bordered precipitously on the knife edge limit between neutron star and black hole. And that's about twice the mass of the sun packed to within 20 kilometers across of space. And the moment that they mess with it, the unknown aggressors somehow collapse the neutron star, releasing a gamma ray burst. And gamma ray bursts are some of the most energetic and violent and powerful explosions in the known universe. And they happen when massive stars collapse into a black hole, or when neutron stars, pairs of neutron stars collide, or even supermassive black hole and neutron star colliding. That would be incredibly awesome right there. That's how you get gamma ray bursts. They're also known as kilonovas. Such things are called kilonovas. Look up GW170817 if you want to go down the rabbit hole of extreme physics. I thought it was great that the story visits these incredible astrophysical objects, the neutron star, in a hypothetical science fiction setting. They more or less get it right. They aren't much to look at, but they have some really incredible effects, like gravitationally, and their magnetic fields are insane. It would have been awesome if the authors were able to mention some aspect of the gravitational waves that would be involved in that kind of event, but that was not the case. I myself study the emission of pulsars, rotating neutron stars, as a way to map the contents of interstellar matter in the galaxy. I have a 3-minute thesis video on my channel explaining exactly what I'm doing. Links in the description down below. You can look at it in my videos list. Now, all in all, although it's currently not the concluding volume of The Expanse, I think Tiamat's Wrath is a great read. I am eager to see how it all ends in the coming 9th book. I'm guessing that it might have something to do with dark matter, dark energy, and interdimensional Cthulhu. Ooh. But that's just speculation. Anyway, thanks for watching. Like, comment, and subscribe, and I will see you next time.